The Air Corps early recognized the importance of guiding these tremendous resources of men and aircraft into channels of peacetime usefulness. To this end, meager appropriations were wisely used in testing and demonstrating the possibilities of aviation by many spectacular flights. For example, the first regular airmail service in the United States was inaugurated by the Army in 1918. President and Mrs. Woodrow Wilson chatted with Maj Fleet, the officer in charge of operations, before the first flight. The schedule provided daily trips between New York and Washington. With safety, efficiency, and economy as watchwords, the Air Corps flew the mail until the venture had been thoroughly established as a tactical service. It was then turned over to the Post Office Department for operation by civilian flyers. Army airplanes continued in use, however, until specially designed commercial planes were available. During 4 years of forest patrol in the far west, Army pilots reported 4,000 fires, saving millions in valuable timber. 1920. What are the possibilities of flying over the snow-covered reaches of Alaska? Leading a flight of four DHs, Captain St. Clair Street flew 9,000 hazardous miles, proving that sledge dogs were no longer the masters of Alaskan fate. 1923. To stimulate the development of long-range flying, both military and commercial, Lieutenants Kelly and Macready made the first non-stop flight across the United States. The heavily loaded Fokker had difficulty clearing the towering Rockies. At 26 hours and 50 minutes after leaving Long Island, the transport arrived at Rockwell Field, the coffee in their thermos jugs still hot. The following year, Lieutenant Maughan made his valuable contribution to speed and distance by making the first dawn-to-dusk flight from coast to coast, breakfast in New York, dinner in San Francisco. From the beginning of aviation history, the outstanding aim of aviators was to achieve the longest of all cross-country flights, circumnavigation of the Earth. In 1924, the Army reached that goal in one of the most carefully planned and executed exploits of modern times. From the day the flight left Seattle, all the elements of nature banded together in their attempt to bring failure to eight pioneers of the air and their four Douglas biplanes. Major Martin, commander of the flight, crashed into a mountain in the Alaskan fog. 9 days later, Martin and his mechanic reached civilization, physically exhausted. The other three planes, with Captain Smith leading, continued westward across the Pacific, Asia, and Europe, battling with snow, rain, excessive heat, typhoons, headwinds, and the turbulent air currents of mountain ranges and deserts. Wade was forced down in the icy Atlantic. His companions directed a Navy destroyer to his position, and he was saved. Smith and Nelson completed the world flight, arriving in Seattle 5 months and 24 days after their departure, 28,000 miles, truly a shining landmark among brilliant achievements. At the end of the trail, Major Martin was on hand with hearty congratulations. Speed and more speed was demanded. Lieutenants Doolittle and Bettis added further laurels to their Air Corps by winning important contests in their powerful little racers. Our traditional desire to live at peace with the world was ably expressed in 1926 when 10 Air Corps officers visited the West Indies and every country of Central and South America, demonstrating the feasibility of linking the Americas by air. President Coolidge commended the trailblazers. 1927. General Patrick bid Godspeed to Lieutenants Hagenberger and Maitland before their takeoff from Oakland in a Fokker transport for Honolulu. The significance of this flight was not that they covered the greatest overseas distance ever flown, but that the instruments developed through years of research for precise navigation by stars, radio, and dead reckoning were practicable. Buffeted by shifting winds, blinded by storms, they were faced by sure death if they were 4 degrees off in their navigation. But their confidence in the equipment and skill in its use won them hard-earned success. The flying range of an airplane depends primarily on fuel capacity. And why not refuel during flight? A tri-motored Fokker, known as the Question Mark, tested this theory early in 1929 when it took off from Rockwell Field, San Diego, for nearly a week aloft. Gasoline was fed into the tank several times daily through a 3-inch hose. Food was transferred by cable to the 5-man crew. After more than 150 hours in the air, motor trouble forced the big transport to Earth. A safe landing was made. Tired? Need a shave? Sure, and a good quiet place for a sleep. But the previous endurance record was more than double. A glorious peacetime use for a wartime weapon. These Curtis Condors are being loaded with 100-pound bags of food for distribution to the Navajo Indians, snowbound for many weeks in the isolated country of Arizona. Indian guides show the pilots where the snow-blanketed hogans of their starving brothers are hidden. Here, an ailing motor would spell sure death, but the war against starvation of 20,000 American brothers must be won. A feast from the clouds, flour, beans, salt meat, coffee, dried fruit, sugar, 15 tons of it, the bread of life to these red men and their starving families. A tornado strikes Texas, leaving its toll of death, destruction, and injury. The Army receives a hurried call for aid. At Kelly Field, the flying ambulance is dispatched to the stricken area. Trained men gently load the seriously injured into the Mercy ship. Off she goes from the rough, muddy pastures, feeding her cargo of unfortunates to distant havens of medical aid. Another frantic appeal for peacetime use of the Army. Floods pour over vast stretches of farmland. Livestock, representing the life savings of hundreds of farmers, huddle together on small hilltops awaiting their doom, while their stranded owners face possible starvation or disease. Food is needed, drinking water, serum, medical supplies, blankets, to stave off the grim reaper. Army bombers drop supplies and report to rescue parties by radio the positions of those in imminent danger. More lives saved. Just another day's work for these peace-loving combat crews as they turn homeward. 1934, 10 Martin bombers led by Lieutenant Colonel H.H. Arnold leave Washington, D.C. for a round-trip survey flight to Alaska. The purpose is to test the feasibility of rapidly moving a mass flight of planes to our most northern territory, accomplishing a mission, and returning home. Upon arrival in Alaska, 21,000 square miles are mapped with aerial cameras in 3 days, a record accomplished despite sub-zero weather. Arriving at the nation's capital, the airmen received from Secretary of War Dern the Mackay Trophy for their brilliant work. November 10, 1935, the gondola is made ready. Nightfall finds 250,000 cubic feet of helium pouring into the largest balloon ever built. A score of specially built instruments will collect scientific data on cosmic rays, the spectrum of the sun, and other mysteries of the stratosphere. As the sun rises over the Black Hills of South Dakota, the order is given, cast off. An Explorer Second is headed for the unbelievable altitude of nearly 14 miles, where the temperature is 78 degrees below zero. 15,000 photographs taken by automatic cameras leave a permanent scientific record of conditions found aloft. Captain Anderson, left, pilot, and Captain Stevens, commander and scientific observer, right, dismantle the delicate instruments, delighted with a job well done.